If you take your Bibles and let's go to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 5. The Holy, now we can laugh. We can laugh and have a good time and don't run God off. God's here. God wants to do work this morning. Are you hearing me? God wants to work in this house this morning. Mark chapter 5 and verse 1. Then they came to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gadarenes. Feel the Holy Ghost. And when he had come out of the boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no one could bind him, not even with chains, because he often been bound with shackles and chains, and the chains had been pulled apart by him, and the shackles broken in pieces. Neither could anyone tame him. Verse 5. And always night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying out and cutting himself with stones. Verse 6. When he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and worshiped him. I want to preach to you this morning. Whatever stopped the storm can stop the storm in me. Whatever stopped that storm can stop the storm in me. Would you pray right now with us in this house? Would you release yourself into the Holy Ghost? Would you let the Spirit of God move through you right now in this place? Hallelujah. Oh God, oh God. I praise you. I magnify you, my King. I worship you, my King. I worship you, my King. I worship you, my King. I thank you, my God. I thank you, my God. I thank you, my God. I thank you. I thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. You may be seated. Maybe seated this morning. Amen. Can I preach? Will you help me preach? Amen. Amen. I don't like sitting in a chair, but it's the best place for me right now. Amen. At this moment. I think we'd all be in agreement today that we're in a storm. We're in a storm as a nation. This world is in a storm. No doubt. No doubt. But we're going to bring it down to you. Some of us in this room are in storms. We are in fierce storms. There are things going on, amen, that attack us and come against us. I remember just a few weeks ago, amen, it seems like a long time ago now, that when I was walking into the emergency room, I turned and I looked at my wife. And I can't even remember what we said. I think I said, I love you. But as I walked into that emergency room, I didn't know if I was going to come back out. And my niece was going in with me, who is an RN, who works in the emergency room. And it troubled her that I would speak as such. But I had a storm going on the inside of me. I did not know. I could not predict what was going to take place. I had already heard about the situations that happen, that when you go in the hospital, you basically become, especially if you are positive for the virus, you become immediately put aside, put in by yourself. And amen. And at that moment, I was really not wanting to be by myself. But that's what took place. Hallelujah. But in that place, God was with me. I went through the storm. I'm still feeling the effects of the storm. But I went through this storm. But this is not about me this morning. I'm looking at people in this audience that you are in a storm. It can be an emotional storm. It can be a physical storm. It can be the attack of an enemy. Our enemy is coming against you. who wants to destroy you. Give me that kind of a storm. This is what's happening again at this time. Last week we preached to you about having compassion. Your pain in my heart. Well, let me continue on. Amen. When you read the story that we just read to you from Mark 5, to get the full effect of what's taking place, you must go into chapter 4. In chapter 4, verse 35, Jesus had said to his disciples, "Let us cross over to the other side." And so they all got in the boat. There wasn't a lot of preparation. They just took him along in this boat. Amen. And the Bible does note that there were other little boats with them. And while they got into that sea, the Bible says that a great windstorm arose and the waves beat into the boat so that it was already filling. Amen. And as they're in this boat and as they are being terrorized by this storm, amen, they notice that Jesus is sleeping on a pillow in the stern of the boat. May I say to you, I'd rather have a sleeping Jesus on my boat than no Jesus on my boat. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so they shook him and said, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" And when he arose from his sleep, the Bible tells us in verse 39 that he rebuked the wind. He said to the wind with authority, with charge, amen, "Stop, peace, be still. Peace, be still." And the scripture says, the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Just hang on. I'm just giving you background right now. The response that it elicited from his disciples was a response of fear. He would ask them, "Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith?" The Bible says in verse 41, they feared exceedingly. But their fear was not just a storm. Their fear involved the one who was in the boat with them. Who can this be? They maybe have thought he was the Messiah, but now they've seen something they had never ever seen before. One who had the ability to stop a storm. Who can this be? Even the wind and the sea obey him. Hallelujah. I want you to know today, I know who that one is. I know who that one is who's coming into your life. I know who that one is that is coming to you. The disciples who had walked with him didn't even seem to understand who he was. Psalms 89:8 says, "O Lord God of hosts, who is mighty like you, O Lord? Your faithfulness also surrounds you. You rule the raging of the sea. When its waves rise, you still them." Amen. I don't know if any of them remembered that psalm, but the one that was in the boat with them was Jehovah of the Old Testament. It was God Almighty in a body of flesh who had come to dwell among them. Amen. That's who's in the boat. I want you to know this morning, you may not see him physically in this house, but he's just as present here right now as he was in the stern of that boat, and he still has the ability to stop the storm. Hallelujah. Oh, how, let's worship God for a moment. Let's praise God. We don't serve an inept God. We don't serve a God, amen, that has no power. We serve the only wise God. Unto him be blessing and honor and glory and power forever. Oh, hallelujah. 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 praise God, then gets in storms that God will begin to reveal himself to you. So you want a pat a cake for Jesus. You want to tiptoe through the tulips. You want everything to work out. Well, that's a place called heaven. And Toto, we ain't there yet. We haven't arrived. We're still here. Now, are you still with me? The demoniac lived on the coast. Now, just because he was demon-possessed doesn't mean he had lost his ability to think. His intellect and his insight. Do you not think that he saw that storm? And not only did he see that storm and the conditions of the sea, but he saw something happen that probably had never happened before in his life. He saw a storm stop. Now, you ain't catching on. Storms don't stop. They subside. He saw a storm stop. Someone or something had power that could stop a storm. I don't know what he was thinking, but the thought comes to me, whatever stopped that storm can stop the storm in me. Whatever stopped that storm can stop the storm in me. And the Bible says that he ran and he worshiped Jesus. This man who had been often bound, this man who had been put in shackles and chains, who had tore them apart, this man who had been under guard, this man who was in the tombs and was tormented and cried out day and night and cut himself with stones, this man ran to Jesus. Why? Because he saw him stop a storm. And if he could stop a storm, then he could stop a storm in me. I'm here to tell somebody in this house today, you may be in a storm, but I know the one who stops storms. I know the one who can move into your life. I know the one who can cause change to take place. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Now, we need to understand. We have all been under satanic attack. We have all in our life been influenced by the enemy. So who are you saying I'm possessed? Well, I don't know. But I'm saying we've all been influenced by the enemy. Paul writes to us in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 1. And he tells us at the beginning of this chapter, he made us alive. And then he goes, had been dead in trespasses and sins. What made us dead? Verse 2. In which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. I want you to know, you may think you've just been such a good person all your life, but you have been under the influence and the attack of the enemy. But I'm here to tell you, whatever stopped the storm, whatever stopped the storm, can stop the storm in me. Now, you and I know who that whatever is. We know that it's Jesus. Amen. We know that he's all powerful. He's almighty. He's omniscient. How we know all those things. We're told by unbelieving folks that God cannot work today. In fact, I read commentary. I listen to preachers. I've heard preachers talk about the book of Acts and say that, well, that was long ago. That was the beginning of the church, and they needed the demonstration that you read about in the book of Acts. And I think to myself, my God, do you not understand the kind of world that we live in right now? Do you not understand what we're facing? If any generation of people needed the one that stops storms, it's this generation right now. This generation right now. Amen. So you may think today that God has got out of the miracle business. Let me ask you a question. Do you believe God did miracles in the Old Testament? Do you believe that God did miracles in the New Testament? Do you believe that Jesus is coming again? Well, he did miracles in the old. He did miracles in the new. Well, we're not part of what you read about in the Gospels, but we believe he's coming. Well, is not his coming going to be a miracle? Well, hallelujah. Are you still with me? Have I lost you? Have you gone away? So they say the days of miracles are over. They also say the Bible is just a book of myths and legends. And they will challenge your faith. They will. Amen. In fact, every generation of believers has been challenged by the skeptic. Every generation of believers. In Isaiah chapter 50, verse 2, God asked a question. Why, when I came, was there no man? Why, when I called, was there none to answer? Is my hand shortened at all that it cannot be redeemed? Or have I no power to deliver? Indeed, with my rebuke, I dry up the sea. I make the rivers a wilderness, and their fish stink because there is no water, and die of thirst. I clothe the heavens with blackness, and I made sackcloth for their covering. The reason you don't respond is because we're taught in the Word of God that the Word must be mixed with faith. I hope and pray this morning that when you enter this house, you are saying, God, I believe you. God, I want you to work in me. I want you to work in our lives. Amen. And you mix the Word of God with faith. Oh, please, brother and sister, you cannot sit there and be the skeptic. You can't sit there and argue from a point, well, he hasn't done anything yet. It doesn't work like that. It's for his glory, for his honor. God works when God chooses to work. And I believe he's still a miracle worker today. I believe he still does the powerful that you read about in the scripture. So you can expect, to run into the naysayer. They're out. In fact, the naysayer may be even in your own home. You need to pray the Holy Ghost down. Paul would talk in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 12. He would say, now we have received not the spirit of the world. When I got the Holy Ghost, that wasn't the spirit of the world. But the Spirit who is from God. Do you hear what happened to you? Now it's your choice how you're going to operate. You can either operate in your flesh or you can allow God's Spirit to work through you. I have not received the Spirit of the world, but I have received the Spirit that comes from God. And look what it says, and we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. Amen. Do you not understand that the Holy Ghost is a teacher to lead us and to guide us to all truth? Do you not understand that things are spiritually discerned? You'd have been at Dothan with the servant of the prophet. And you got up that morning and you looked out and you saw all those chariots and all that army surrounding that city. And you said, oh my God, are we in trouble? Oh, things are not looking good right now. And he wakes the prophet up and says, oh, prophet of God, we're in trouble. We're in serious trouble. Look at that army. They've all come to get you, prophet. They've all come to take you and kill you. And you know what the prophet did? Oh, Father, open his eyes. That he may see that there are more with us than against us. And you read it out of the Old Testament. When his eyes were open, he saw the fiery chariots of God that were around. That I'm here to tell you, some things aren't naturally discerned. Some things are not naturally discerned. Amen. They are not understood by the wisdom of men. But the Holy Spirit, as it says in verse 13, teaches us to compare spiritual things with spiritual things. But the natural man, it says in verse 14, the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God. Why? They're foolishness to him. Nor can he know them because they are, again, spiritually discerned. Are you with me? Is this too much? You know, I can stop right here if I need to. Amen. So, I want you to listen carefully. In the realm of reality, it just not man's. Let me repeat it again. In the realm of reality, not man's, but God's realm of reality, anything is possible. We as believers, my friend, if you're measuring yourself by men's efforts today, if you're looking at your crippled situation today and say, I don't even know how I'm going to get out of it. If you're expecting man to give you the answer, all man can give you is natural. We need to look into the realm of the Spirit. We need to look into that realm where God operates. Amen. And in that realm, anything is possible. Do you not understand throughout the Scripture that realm is painted? Jehoshaphat, who in 2 Chronicles chapter 20 is surrounded by an enemy that has come to destroy him. And he has had to deal with fear. When he goes to prayer, he's not thinking of how much they have as far as strength. Amen. How much they have of provisions. Amen. He's not thinking of those things. In fact, he will say in his prayers, we are weak. Amen. We don't even know what to do. And then he'll say, but we look to you. But when he begins to pray, and hear me, my friend, today, you must establish in your life a way to pray. You don't start with your problem. You start with addressing God. Amen. 2 Chronicles chapter 20 and verse 6. Oh, Lord God, our fathers, are you not God in heaven? And do you not rule over all the kingdoms of the nations? And in your hand is there no power and might, so that you no one is able to withstand you. Amen. When we go to prayer, it's time to understand we have a Father. Amen. And he is the creator of the heavens and the earth. And there's nothing that can stand. In the book of Isaiah chapter 40, amen, God through the prophet says, all the nations of the world are but just a drop in the bucket. Every nation, everybody. Amen. We are like grasshoppers in his sight. Amen. The God that I serve, the God that has made me his son. Amen. Made you sons and daughters. Does not John teach us in 1 John chapter, amen, 3. Beloved, now you are the sons of God. My Father controls it all. My Father reigns on high. Even in Kenosha, God is working right now. And whatever stopped that storm, whatever stopped that storm can stop the storm in me. Amen. already told you where most of us can focus. Amen. Israel, when it was in the wilderness, would rather focus on the problem than God's ability to handle the problem. Israel is indicted by Rahab the harlot in Jericho. Rahab was not under covenant with God. Are you still here? You don't understand the importance of covenant. Israel was under covenant with God. Rahab was not. Let me say, as a believer, when you are buried in his name, you are entering into covenant with God. You are under covenant. You need to read Colossians chapter 2. You need to understand that as a New Testament believer, I am under a covenant. You can go back, amen, to Matthew 26, and I think it's verse 26, when Jesus is instituting what we call the Lord's Supper, he will say to them, "This blood is shed for you for what? For the new covenant, or the New Testament, or the new will." I am covenanted with God today. You ain't getting it. It ain't registering with you. Israel was covenanted with God. But here's a woman who's not under covenant with God, who understands that God is powerful. It seems to me, when I read her testimony, the only eyes that had been opened had been the eyes of those not under covenant. Listen to what she says in Joshua chapter 2 and verse 10. "For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea." That had happened 40 years before. "For when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites," which was much more close to where they're at now, "who were on the other side of the Jordan, Shihon and Og, and whom you utterly destroyed. And as soon as we heard these things," I'm talking about people that aren't covenant with God, "our hearts melted. Neither did there remain any more courage in anyone because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and on the earth beneath." This is not coming from a covenant Israelite. This is coming from a woman who is not part of covenant, who has recognized that God has great ability and power. What stopped Israel from going into Canaan? What caused them, amen, to spend another 38 years in a wilderness? It wasn't the giants. It wasn't the great walled cities. It simply was their unbelief. Oh, brothers and sisters, we're a part of something that's great today. You need to believe God. You need to believe God. Amen. In this hour, you need to humble yourself before him. Amen. Don't be like the Gentiles that would say, "Why should the Gentiles say, so there is, so where is your God?" Our God is in heaven, and he does whatever he pleases to do. My God is alive and well. My God still stops the storm. My God can stop the storm in you. He can stop the storm. He can stop that storm today in you. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So when you come to him, the example prayer in Matthew 6, how does it begin? Most of us know it. "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name." Well, who is this one that's hallowed and holy? Isaiah would say in 57:15, "For thus says the high and the lofty one who inhabits the eternity, whose name is holy, I dwell in a high and a holy place with him who is a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble. Amen. And to revive the heart of the contrite one. For I will not contend forever, he says, nor will I always be angry, for the spirit would fail before me, the spirit of man that is, and the souls which I have made. Yeah, that's our Father. He's still in control. He stops storms. And he can come to you today if you would just believe him. He can come to you today if you just believe him. And he can stop the storm in your life today. Yeah. Yeah. He can. You're looking to everyone else for an answer. You're trying to find, some of you are drowning your sorrow in drink. Some of you are taking drugs just to get you through the day. Some of you are involving yourself in things just that are not godly. Just somehow to get through. I'm here to tell you there's one who stops the storms. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Can I go a little farther? Can you continue to pray? The Spirit of God is now already, you've got to pray. You can't be the stone face and just, you got to begin to cry out to God. That's what the Word of God, it tells us to humble ourselves, and it tells us to cry out to him. That's what it says. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There was no worse storm than the storm of a father whose son constantly was cast into the fire and into the water. Satan was trying to destroy that boy. Satan had power in that little boy's life. And that father had brought his son to the disciples of Jesus. Jesus is up on the Mount of Transfiguration with Peter, James, and John. And as he comes off the mount, he sees what is taking place. The father runs to him, cries out to him, Lord, help my boy. He's vexed by his spirit. And Jesus will say to that man, do you believe? And the response of that man in Mark 9:25 is, Lord, I believe. And then he says something, help my unbelief. You see, that sounds like a contradiction. No, you got to know the facts, ladies and gentlemen. He has just had his boy prayed for, and they couldn't get that spirit out of him. And there's argument, and there's fuss going on, and there's men that are even not godly that are arguing with the disciples. And so his mind is dealing with the situation, and he recognizes, I want to believe you, God. But there's something in me. There's this unbelief. And if you look and study the scripture, nowhere does Jesus criticize him because of his frailty and struggle. Are you hearing what I'm saying today? Just because you struggled, that doesn't cause God to walk out on you. That doesn't cause God to say, well, amen, I'm done with you. I'll move on to somebody else. Huh. What's he do? He rebukes the unclean spirit with authority and charges it to come out, and it comes out. Whatever stopped that storm can stop the storm in me. In Luke 4, oh my God, in Luke 4, Jesus has been to the synagogue. He now enters Simon Peter's house. Simon Peter's mother-in-law is sick with a fever. In fact, the Bible says a high fever. Anybody know about that kind of stuff? And so they made request of Jesus. And the Bible tells us in 4:39 of Luke He stood over her and he rebuked the fever. And it left her, and immediately she rose and served. Hey, ladies and gentlemen, believe God. If not, they'll start with a headache. Pray a headache out of that body. Pray a headache out of that individual. Jesus, amen, rebuked a fever and it left. So, let me just share with you. I do not today believe that that storm on the Sea of Galilee was a natural storm. I believe it was a supernatural storm. What was going on? The enemy did not want Jesus to get to that demoniac. This is one of my trophies. Look how I control him. Look what I've done to him. And that Jesus is on the waters. I don't for a moment believe that storm was a natural storm. And he rebukes it. Rebukes the storm. Now, when that man comes to Jesus, the demons will speak through him. They will beg Jesus to not send him out of the country. They will beg Jesus to go into the pigs. And you'll read in the scripture that the pigs didn't want him. And they ran violently down the hill and into the sea and drowned. Are you willing to live with something that even pigs don't want to live with? Are you willing to let the storm in your life continue to rage? Or do you want the one who calms the storm? Do you want that one? Now I am coming to a close. If you read the Gospel of Matthew, you will see in Matthew's gospel what he says in Matthew 8:28 is that there were two demon-possessed men coming out of the tombs, exceedingly fierce. But yet you read in any other gospels, it only focuses on one. Now I've read the commentary, I can read. And so many just simply assume that this man was delivered. But I have to tell you, the scripture's silent. It doesn't speak of this other demoniac. It doesn't say anything about him being delivered. And then some will argue, well, you see, the one that, you know, only one did all the speaking, he was like the chief one. But the Bible tells us they both were exceedingly furious. Is it possible today that the one stayed away? Is it possible today that instead of two coming down to worship him, only one came to worship him? Is it possible today that only one was delivered? You can argue this six ways to Sunday. Where are you at today? Where are you at right now? Where are you at? Let's focus on us right now. Let's focus on us. Are you going to let the storm rage in your life? Are you going to let it to continue to trouble you and vex you and disturb you and work against you? Are you going to let it continue? You know, Satan is a liar. He promotes strife and violence. He's been doing that ever since the garden. It was his hand that was on the hand of Cain when Cain slew his brother Abel. And it's been like that from that time. In fact, amen, you will read that before the flood, the scripture says that the earth was corrupt and the earth was filled with violence. Why? Because now the one of evil had a place on this planet. And he created an awful storm. Whatever stopped the storm can stop the storm in me. Can we bow our heads in this room? Can we bow our heads in this room today? The mercies and grace of God is in this place. His presence is here right now. His presence. As Isaiah told us, God responds to everyone that humbles themselves before Him. James said it like this: God gives grace to the humble, but He resists the proud. Submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. So if all of us in this room right now would just take a moment and ask God to forgive us. God, I told my brother, Brother East, the other day, I struggle to believe sometimes. And he sort of chuckled. And he said, Father, that's a common problem. In other words, he was implying that there were times that he also struggled. I come to you today, Jesus. I surely want to believe you. I surely want to believe you. But some storms are so great. Some storms are so powerful. Some storms seem to be so lasting. I'm asking you, Father, to come even into this room now. I humble myself before you. I humble myself before you. Oh God, whatever stopped that storm can stop the storm in me. Amen. You had a storm in your life today. I'm not trying to attack you. I'm not trying to belittle you. I'm not trying to say that you're not wanting to walk with God. You got a storm today. Can we just sort of gather in the front here? Space ourselves out. Can we do that right now? If you would, you're struggling with a storm. You're battling a battle. It's hurting you. It's trying to suffocate you. It's trying to do things to you. It's against you. Some of that storm is an attack of the enemy against you. You know, last Sunday, you were fine. I was fine last Sunday. Everything seemed to be great. Then it all turned south on us. I had calls from ministers I hadn't seen for a long time, heard from. I want to know how we were doing. Are we still here? Yeah, oh yeah. How close are you to what's going on? Well, I'm not too far. About a mile. How's your church doing? Well, we're still limping along. But you see, I got a God that can rebuke any storm. Any storm. Would you call on Him right now? Whatever your storm is, whatever your storm is, He hears you. He hears you. Whatever your storm is, in the name of Jesus, my Father, it's recorded in your word. You rebuke the storm. In the name of Jesus, rebuke the storm in my brothers and sisters. In Jesus' name, say, peace, be still. Stop it dead in its tracks, God. Stop it dead in its tracks, God. Stop it dead in its tracks, God. Fill me with your presence, God. Fill me in the Holy Ghost, God. Fill me through and through, God. Today, let's call on Him. Let's call on Him. Ha ha. Ha ha. You've disturbed Him. He's in the stern of the boat. He's getting up. And when He gets up, He's going to speak to the storm. You hear me? When He gets up, He's going to speak to the storm. And He's going to say, peace, be still. And it's going to have to stop. It's no longer going to be able to reign. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Come on, brothers and sisters. I encourage you to call on Him. I encourage you to reach out to Him. Oh God, I know some of them are tough. I know it's awful. It's not right. It's unjust. But it's happened. Oh God. Oh God, we need you, God. We need you, God. We need you, God. We need you, Father. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. You begin to rebuke that storm. You begin to rebuke that storm. By the power and authority of the name of Jesus, you begin to rebuke that storm by His name. Do you understand? He's given believers power and authority. We can rebuke the storm. Even if it's a storm in us, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, I say, quiet yourself. In the name of Jesus, amen. Give me back my sane mind, God. Give me back a balance. Give me back your power, God. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. In the name. I will not operate in fear, God. I will not allow fear to haunt me and torment me, God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen. You stop the storm, and you can stop the storm in me.